In this video, we will see determinants of GFR. In previous video, we saw that GFR is 125 ml per minute. Mathematically, it is equal to filtration coefficient multiplied by net filtration pressure. Filtration coefficient is determined by glomerular capillary wall hydraulic conductivity, or in simple words, its permeability and the surface area available for glomerular filtration. The higher the conductivity and larger the surface area, the higher will be the GFR. Net filtration pressure is determined by Stirling forces. These forces are hydrostatic pressure and colloid osmotic pressure in the glomerulus and in Bowman's capsule. Let's see each pressure one by one. Hydrostatic pressure in glomerulus is essentially blood pressure in the glomerulus. It promotes filtration. It is about 60 mmHg. It is the highest capillary pressure in the body. No other capillary in the body has this much high pressure. This high pressure is due to the difference in diameters of efferent and afferent arterioles, which is smaller in efferent arterioles. As we saw in video of renal blood flow, this pressure changes with changing resistance of afferent and efferent arterioles. Increase in afferent arteriolar resistance causes fall in this pressure, whereas increase in efferent arteriolar resistance causes rise in this pressure. Hydrostatic pressure in Bowman's capsule opposes filtration. It is about 15 mmHg. Now the colloid osmotic pressure of glomerular capillaries. It is basically osmotic pressure exerted by plasma proteins. It opposes filtration. The higher the protein concentration, the higher the pressure. It is about 30 mmHg at the afferent end of the glomerular capillary. As plasma moves ahead, water is removed. But protein molecules stay inside the glomerulus. So they get concentrated as plasma moves ahead. This leads to rise in this pressure as we move distally along the glomerular capillary. It becomes about 35 mmHg at efferent end of the capillary, as compared to 30 mmHg at the afferent end. Actually, the final osmotic pressure at the efferent end depends on filtration fraction. We know what filtration fraction is, right? It is the ratio of GFR to renal plasma flow. It shows how much of incoming plasma is filtered. With normal filtration fraction of 20%, osmotic pressure rises to 35 mmHg. In case of increase in GFR or decrease in renal plasma flow, filtration fraction increases, means relatively more fluid is filtered. In such conditions, proteins get more concentrated. So osmotic pressure rises above 35 mmHg. On the other hand, if GFR reduces or renal plasma flow increases, filtration fraction decreases, means relatively less fluid is filtered. So protein molecules are not concentrated much. So pressure does not rise even up to 35 mmHg and stays somewhere between 30 to 35 mmHg. Thus, final osmotic pressure depends on filtration fraction. I hope everything is clear so far, because now I am going to further expand this flowchart. We saw that final osmotic pressure depends on filtration fraction. Now this filtration fraction, in turn, ultimately depends on resistance of afferent and efferent arterioles. First, let's see effect of afferent arteriolar resistance. When it increases, capillary hydrostatic pressure falls, resulting in reduction in GFR. It also reduces renal plasma flow. As GFR and renal plasma flow both are decreasing, filtration fraction is relatively unaffected. So there is not much change in osmotic pressure with changing afferent arteriolar resistance. However, things are different in case of efferent arteriole. When efferent arteriolar resistance increases, capillary hydrostatic pressure increases, which increases GFR. But plasma flow is reduced. Here, GFR is increasing, but renal plasma flow is falling. This results in an increase in filtration fraction. And so, osmotic pressure increases. In a nutshell, constriction of efferent arteriole causes increase in osmotic pressure, whereas changes in afferent arteriolar resistance does not affect osmotic pressure much. Now, colloid osmotic pressure of proteins in Bowman's capsule. It promotes filtration. Under normal conditions, the concentration of proteins in glomerular filtrate is so low that colloid osmotic pressure in Bowman's capsule is considered to be zero. And finally now, putting all these pressures together, net filtration pressure is 15 mmHg at the afferent end and 10 mmHg at the efferent end of the capillary. So these are the factors that determine the GFR. Now let's see the same concepts with a different perspective. Among these factors, glomerular capillary pressures are the most important as far as regulation of GFR is concerned. As we have just seen, both of them are ultimately controlled by efferent and efferent arteriolar resistance. So far we have seen the effect on hydrostatic and osmotic pressures separately. Now let's see how both of them are affected together and final effect on GFR. First, effect of efferent arteriolar resistance. This graph shows the effect of efferent arteriolar resistance on GFR. As you can see, rising efferent arteriolar resistance causes fall in GFR. This is because rising efferent arteriolar resistance causes fall in glomerular hydrostatic pressure. Fall in hydrostatic pressure tends to decrease GFR. However, it does not affect colloid osmotic pressure much. So GFR falls as a result of fall in hydrostatic pressure. Now effect of efferent arteriolar resistance. Here, rising efferent arteriolar resistance initially causes rising GFR, whereas at very high efferent arteriolar resistance, GFR starts to fall. Why is it so? Let's see. We know that rising efferent arteriolar resistance causes increase in hydrostatic pressure. This tends to increase GFR. However, it also causes increase in colloid osmotic pressure in glomerulus and this tends to decrease GFR. Initially, when resistance is at lower range, effect of rising hydrostatic pressure dominates, so GFR increases. But when resistance is too high, blood flow becomes very slow. This leads to much accumulation of proteins, which in turn leads to massive increase in colloid osmotic pressure. So its effect predominates and GFR falls. So these were the factors determining GFR. In next video, we will see how renal blood flow and GFR are regulated. If you find this video helpful, please share it with your colleagues and subscribe for more videos. See you in next video.